almost all of us are born selfish. Our parents encourage us to be selfish. But Malaysia is very competitive. You know, you want to be better than the other person. But I want to argue that we have to move beyond selfishness. We cannot just be selfish and work in this world, especially if you want to improve this world. Many years ago, I wrote a book called Beyond Me and Mine, where I argued actually that it is necessary for human beings all over the world to really think beyond themselves and their family, if they really want to help address the global problems. And the global problems, you know, are that climate change, for example, is staring us in the face. We see evidence, this huge polar ice cap that has melted in Antarctica, the biggest iceberg known ever, is moving up, partly due to climate change. There are droughts and fires and floods all over the world which are worse than before. What more signs do we need? Trump, of course, is not the person to be counted as the president of the US. Right? So, I would argue that although some people argue that selfishness is necessary for survival, I think we are no longer at the stage where we can only talk about survival of the fittest. We have to talk about survival of the earth. And to me, I've always argued that whether you're an undergraduate or whether you're a corporate person, you can make the change. But the change can only occur if you're going to think beyond the selfishness. For example, people say, okay, climate change is a big issue. I can't do anything about it. You can. You can start by yourself. By changing your lifestyle, by reducing your energy consumption. Simple things, for example. If you are used to living in a house with air conditioners on everywhere, cut down the usage of air conditioners. Increase the setting of your air conditioners so they are not at 15 degrees centigrade and you're shivering away. Many universities and government buildings, you have to wear jackets to continue with your lectures and all. Why do we have to do that? Those are energy wasteful. So for every kilowatt of electricity we save, whether in the house or the office, we are saving, at least in Peninsula Malaysia, 1 kg of CO2. Imagine if every Malaysian was to do that. Similarly, your petrol. You know, I try to lead a simple life. I don't own a car since 1978. I travel by public transport. My advantage is I don't have to go to work, drive to work every day because my office is next to my bedroom. I only have to travel for meetings, like here. So since 78, I've traveled by public transport. Today, I had to ask food to pick me up at the MRT station. That is the part where I had to compromise because I wasn't sure whether I would get here on time because last time I checked on the MRT route map and they didn't show any of the MRT buses that were coming here. Otherwise, I wouldn't be here on time. So there are compromises that you make, but you have to make conscious decisions. And at the undergraduate level, there are many, many opportunities available for you. When I talk to young people, especially people who are used to having smartphones, I have a smartphone but I switched off at the moment because I only switched it off when I need it, and I use my smartphone actually more in the place, instead of looking for a public phone, then I go and use my smartphone to make calls. And people argue, why do you have a smartphone and why don't you have it on? I have young staff coming to work with CETDEM who say, why don't you let us have our smartphones on all the time? I said, then how do you attend to your office work? You'll be answering your WhatsApp and all the things all the time. So I think what a lot of people don't realize, young people, when they think they're going green, especially they think they're being unselfish, they forget that there are simple, simple things in their life that they throw away. Smartphones are one of them. When a new smartphone comes, you forget about the old smartphone and you want to get a new one. What happens to the old smartphone? What happened to all the resources that were used to produce a smartphone? Is it being recycled anywhere? Or is it being given to people who are not so well off so they have access to a phone? No, you don't think of that. So what they're saying on one hand, people say we are being unselfish, going out to green the world, you plant a tree. But you plant a tree, you don't maintain the tree dies. People don't think through. So if you want to do environmental, ecologically friendly government, unselfish manner, do think through. What are the consequences? Because in life, there is no perfect solution. There are trade-offs. You have want to have a smartphone which actually uses RAMs, which are produced by Linus, which creating a lot of problems in one time. The more headphones you use, the more such waste will be generated. you then have to say, okay, can I keep it minimum so that the amount of smartphones produced has to reduce, or can I make sure my smartphone is used elsewhere before I change to a new model, sort of thing. So this is what is important. The other thing I talked, you know, within this environmental movement too long, maybe before most of you were born, since 1974. Right? And I've seen a lot of things happening and not very much change happening. Mainly because there are too many Western selfish interests around. For example, the Klang River remains as polluted now as it was in 1974. And the government is only now having a river of life project, which is very, very expensive, and which, in my opinion, is not going to solve the problem because it's not tackling the problem at source. The problem, tackling the problem at source is at the factories, houses, and even your coffee shop, that throw all your waste into the drain. It goes into the drain, but it goes into the Klang River. So you can clean the Klang River, but forever, if you don't stop that waste from getting into the Klang River, it will keep on being polluting the river itself. And that is what I've been laughing. I said, we do not in our country address root causes. We address symptoms, and then we do not find out the real root causes and don't solve the problems. And even somebody is working on this project with me the other day, you know, we are really frustrated because we go to the shop houses, we talk to them about this and all that. They said, nobody comes to enforce the regulation because the DPKL health inspector don't even bother to come and visit them. And every time they visit them, they want this only. They don't find them for all the food that they go on into the trade. And all this food is entering the river. So this has been one of my real frustrations in tackling environmental problems, even environmental organizations. Remember recently, there were these major floods in Kelantan. They got very excited about logging. And they said, oh, logging is the main cause. And I said, no, it's not logging. It's the whole land mismanagement we have. We don't control the cutting of hills. We don't control the building of houses. You look at all the housing development going around here. Look at the slope. Rain and sun comes and washes the silt into the drain. What happens? The drain gets silted up. Whenever there's a slightest rain, they flow into the road. Fracture. Not surprising. But this has been going on for the last 40 years. I mean, my voice is hoarse asking for changes and improvements. So I think if you really want to fight environmental issues, go beyond the superficial, beyond what I call the greenwashing, and be really sure that you're unselfish, and you need to join groups, you need to campaign, you need to speak up. And I'm happy that at least the internet now is providing a venue for you to speak up. Although, of course, it's getting censored. During my early days, I had to rely on the mass media, and the mass media, you know, in this country is censored. There were times when I was totally blacked out for 6 months, my name would not appear, and people say, what's wrong with you? You go quiet? I said, go and ask the media. They are blacking out every one of my statements. So now you have the internet. Use it responsibly. Get yourself mobilized. Don't let the people in power get away with stupid decisions that are undermining the environment. And organize groups. And this is what I think is necessary. Many of them, I say, don't bother. I take care of myself only as long as I make money. I don't care. I think that is, to me, the height of folly and the height of selfishness. When you only think of yourself and your family, you don't think of the country, you don't think of the community, and you don't think of the environment. The other point I want to mention is caring for others, not just caring for animals. You know, chemical companies have a program, what they call responsible care, because they've been criticized, the chemical industry, for polluting the environment. But you should examine, what are they, how are they caring? What have they done really to reduce the polluting? Many people talk about hazardous waste, but a lot of people don't talk about hazardous chemicals. In this country, we don't have a chemicals act that registers all the chemicals and indicate the toxicity. There's no chemical register like in the EU. So chemical companies are producing products on the market which are hazardous to the health, and none of you know about it, even in the household. Some paints that have material that is hazardous to children, that some products are made of material that is hazardous. But at the moment, there's no control about it. And so as a result, everybody is excited about hazardous waste, but they don't talk about hazardous products. And I've been outspoken all my life, and I pay that price. So my choice always has been, do I compromise? In fact, I went to see somebody many years ago who's a Tan Sri still around. I said, can you tell me, how can I get money? You know, we're having this problem. You might learn to do what so-and-so did, won't name the person. He said, he served. When I spoke to that Prime Minister at that time, he managed to get a huge amount of money, but he not speaking out on the issues that he was speaking up before. He said, no, I work all my life, I'm not going for the sake of money to be shut up for the sake of a million ringgit or 2 million ringgit. So that's a price. And I think you, one of the things would be unselfish is to be willing to pay the price. And if you're not willing to pay the price, then don't get involved. Then remain selfish. Perhaps you may be very happy selfish. But I would argue that you are going to eventually, circumstances around you are going to change your life because things are changing as a result of inaction by all individuals all the world. You know, I followed the climate negotiations for more than 20 years after they started, and my big frustration is all these government negotiators are not leading us anywhere. The problem is we don't have a people's mass movement to push for this. That is the only way, ultimately, I think, global issues will be resolved. But we have to work on people's movement. And you are the young people, you will be at stake when climate changes. Not me, I will be probably dead and gone by the time the real disaster strikes. When temperatures increase by more than 2 degrees centigrade, when species die away, when polar ice melts and oceans rise. That's a prediction, if all the polar ice melts, sea levels will rise 7 meters. And you can think of what the consequences will be. 7 meters sea level rise. Almost all the major cities in the world, including Shanghai, Kolkata, Mumbai, will be all flooded with 7 meters sea level rise. But despite this staring in the face, we have too much vested interest among nations. The Californian Parliament recently passed legislation to allow them to continue the cut and trade system that brings emissions down in California itself. And the Californian economy is bigger than many countries' economies itself. So there are cities and provinces that are setting the example, but not the United States. I think my time is almost up. I'll stop here. Thank you very much.